Okay, good afternoon, good morning, everybody. Good evening. I'm Simon Morrison, and I'm pleased to introduce the two speakers grouped together on a session called Miscellaneous, which means that these are the two most distinct and impressive papers. I'm first of all going to introduce William Hussey, who's at Chicago College of Performing Arts at Roosevelt University in downtown Chicago. He's the head there of core studies, as his bio says. He came from Louisiana State University, master's from UT Austin, and he specializes in the thing he's going to be talking about today, which is interdisciplinary work in terms of music, Shostakovich primarily, but also Brahms, published with MTO, Music Theory Online, and has done a lot of conference presentations as well. And the title of his talk is A Polyphonic Discussion, quote unquote, around polyphonic, Shostakovich's 13th quartet, King Lear, and the 14th symphony. So Professor Hussey.
Thank you. You can see my screen fine?
Not yet.
Nope, okay. Let me go.
There we go.
Okay, please let me know if any audio issues are going along as I'll be reading. Okay, here we go. A polyphonic discussion, Shostakovich's 13th quartet, King Lear and the 14th symphony. Shostakovich's 14th symphony is unique among the composer's 15 symphonies, for it is an 11-movement song cycle using texts from four different poets that explore the subject of death from different perspectives. Using the work of literary critic and philosopher Mikhail Bakhtin, Christian Hibbard describes Shostakovich's compositional approach to the symphony as polyphonic.
The polyphonic author is not absent from the work, but assumes a radically different position within it. He relinquishes the objectivized, omniscient control over characters and events and treats the text as an equal partner in a discussion.
Bakhtin's concept of polyphony seems wholly appropriate in understanding the relationship between the composer and the 11 different texts informing such a distinctive work. According to the composer's good friend Isaac Glickman, the symphony is directly related to a piece Shostakovich wrote shortly after.
The tragic paragraphs of the 13th quartet I saw as a younger sibling of the 14th symphony.
Glickman's comment suggests that the polyphonic relationship of the composer to the varied texts within the symphony can be extended or continued into the 13th quartet. At the same time he was working on Symphony No. 14, Shostakovich was completing a film score to Shakespeare's King Lear, his final collaboration with the famed director Grigory Kozintsev. At Kozintsev's request, Shostakovich composed another death-related piece, a lament intended to accompany the death and destruction of the concluding scenes of war, what Kozintsev would describe as a tribal community raising its voice in lamentation for the dead. Peter Schmeltz identified the music of this lament reappearing in the 13th quartet as well.
At the beginning of the quartet, a lone row in the solo viola slides into the full ensemble's intonation of a mournful passage in D-flat, a previously unidentified quotation of number 67, Lament, from Shostakovich's 1970 film music to Kozintsev's King Lear.
The 13th quartet, associated by Glickman and Schmeltz with the symphony and film score, augments the polyphonic discussion of death started by the previous two works. Shostakovich often chose the string quartet medium for his most intimate and private reflections, and with this in mind, perhaps quartet number 13 adds another, more personal voice to his polyphonic discussion on mortality. This paper will explore what prompted Glickman and Schmeltz to connect these three works together and where the quartet fits in the polyphonic discussion. One of the distinguishing characteristics of the single movement 13th quartet is the 12-tone melodies that appear in every section of the piece. Shostakovich's 12-tone writing is only found in 9 pieces of his entire output, and it is the 12th quartet, the 14th symphony, and the 13th quartet that are, by most estimations, the one in which 12-tone writing is most pervasive. In these works, Shostakovich uses multiple 12-tone rows, contrary to the Schoenbergian tradition that uses a single dodecaphonic row as a source of material for the entire work. Of the many rows used in the 13th quartet, the most prominent is the row that opens the piece, a desolate 12-tone viola solo that depicts that, despite its chromaticism, asserts the quartet's key of B flat minor through its harmonic implications. The initial motive of the viola's row, so distinctive in its contour, motivic consistency, and expressive qualities, comes to dominate the music, not unlike the DSCH motive does in the 8th quartet. Like most of Shostakovich's 12-tone rows, its placement within a tonal environment gives it a distinguishing quality as noted by Hans Keller in his work on the 12th quartet.
By placing his 12-tone rows within a pronouncedly tonal context, Shostakovich lends them a novel function. Not only is their motivic significance thrown into relief, but the manifold interrelations between them emerge with crystalline clarity. They inevitably impress themselves intensely upon the aural attention whenever they occur.
The opening row aptly demonstrates Shostakovich's harmonic and motivic consistency in his 12-tone writing, similar to that in Symphony No. 14. It will also appear later in this presentation in connection with the music for King Lear. The musical links between the 14th Symphony and the 13th Quartet are many. The bass line of the symphony's second movement, Malaguena, a 12-tone row organized in four-note groups. Is similar to the four pitch groupings of the 12-tone row played in the cello pizzicato from the quartet's central section. The seventh leaps in an anapest rhythm found in the movement sixth of the symphony appear in an inverted fashion in the viola line of the quartet. The woodblocks that knock in counterpoint to the 12-tone fugue of the symphony's seventh movement. Are imitated in the counterpoint knocks of the quartet as the second violinist and cellist strike their bows against the bellies of their instrument. These are but technical similarities, and many more striking images exist. The 13th Quartet and 14th Symphony share an extraordinary musical image, one of a terrifying scream that was first expressed in the symphony and later realized in several remarkable ways within the quartet. The passages in these pieces I will refer to have often been highlighted by analysts for their striking aural effects, but rarely have they been associated with each other. In the symphony, the image appears in the fourth movement that sets the poem of The Suicide by Guillaume Apollinaire.
Three tall lilies on my grave without a cross. One springs from my wound, and when touched by a ray, rises blood-stained. It's the lily of fear. Another springs from my heart, which suffers on the bed where it's gnawed by worms. The other springs from my mouth.
The third and final lily, rising from the suicide's mouth, is realized by Shostakovich as a musical scream, with a soprano presenting the text in its highest notes of the movement. The aural effect is also intensified as each of the 12 pitches entering successively in an ascending chromatic scale from D within the 12-part string divisi. Notice how, after all 12 notes appear, the entire cluster ascends by 4 half-steps before the chimes toll, making an already cacophonous passage even more so. One can almost imagine the body in the grave arching its back as if reliving the pain of death and falling limp with the tolling bells. It is an intense and remarkable passage, not only for its musical imagery, but also because the concluding chimes allude to another moment of death in the symphony's previous movement, and to the composer's Symphony No. 13. Furthermore, this is a rare harmonic realization of a 12-tone passage in Shostakovich's music, described by Peter Schmelz in this way.
It is a wash of sound, more akin to the noise experiments of the Polish avant-garde, termed sonorica by the Soviets, than anything 12-tone.
In the 13th quartet, similar scream-like passages appear with chord clusters created by successive entrances of notes a half-step apart. An overt reference to the symphony's suicidal scream in the quartet occurs at rehearsal 17. Here, the four instruments enter in succession in double-stop octaves a half-step apart, just as it was in the symphony's passage. After a punctuating anapest rhythm in descending sevenths, heard previously in the viola, the successive chromatic passage is now expanded, with each part now entering not with octaves, but with double-stop ninths, creating an eight-note cluster. This sonority's violent tone only increases as it is repeated with the anapest rhythm and successive downbows, taking the shrieking symphonic passage to a new level of intensity. The quartet surpasses the power of this moment in its remarkable conclusion, incredibly by way of a single note. In the quartet's final moments, the viola plays an extensive monologue using several 12-tone rows, effectively erasing any sense of the B-flat tonic with the 12-tone passage. The viola climbs to that note towards an astonishing conclusion. Elizabeth Wilson heard this final note and its crescendo as a scream, and Eric Roseberry called it a shriek. Compared to the harmonic clusters used to create this effect earlier in the quartet and in the symphony, the single pitch is even more chilling. The associations between the 14th Symphony and 13th Quartet exist more through similar compositional techniques. Some of the similarities of these passages reach into the realm of illusion. But the most direct reference within the 13th Quartet to another work lies in a quotation from Shostakovich's musical score he composed to accompany the movie King Lear, a quotation whose significance has mostly gone uncommented upon by those who noticed it. Shostakovich generally viewed writing film scores with disdain, but when working with the director of Grigory Kozintsev's caliber, Shostakovich eagerly participated. Having provided music for Kosenzev's stage productions of Hamlet and King Lear, the two would reunite for film versions of the two Shakespeare plays, Hamlet released in 1964 and King Lear in 1970. The quotation from King Lear in the 13th Quartet is taken from number 67, Lament, music Kosenzev wanted to depict the death and destruction of the war between the English forces under the Earl of Gloucester's treacherous and illegitimate son, Edmund, and the French army led by Lear's only faithful daughter, Cordelia. In a letter to Shostakovich, who was unable to be on set due to his health, Kosenzev described what he wanted in the music.
The longest musical episode is the war. We tried to show madness, chaos, and destruction on the screen. But I would like the theme of the music to be associated not with ruin or the raging power of destruction, but rather with grief, human suffering, which has no limits. Not some individual complaint, but the grief of the whole people. In Shakespearean dimensions, it is the lament of the earth itself, a requiem, perhaps, only not with an orchestra, but the chorus alone and without words. Grief has no words. There is nothing but weeping. The women, the children, and the men all weep.
Using Kosenzev's description, Shostakovich titled the music for this scene as Lament. The director described this music in the diary he kept during King Lear's filming.
The Lament was written in the form of 9 fragments, separated by pauses, each one having its peculiar timbre and intonation. Shostakovich gave me the option of changing their sequence, repeating one of the fragments over and over again, or using them singly. This was not film music, but cinema itself. It is fundamental flesh and blood, what makes the editing, the shots. 9 new shots were introduced into the film, 9 crowd scenes.
In this scene from the film, we shall see Edgar placing the cross on the grave of his father, the Earl of Gloucester, paying his final respects, and then walking towards the battle to confront his treacherous half-brother, Edmund, as Shostakovich's lament begins. The quotation in the quartet is from the first of the 9 fragments, essentially the same music with some changes in meter, realized with the 4 strings corresponding to the 4 vocal parts. The question is actually just 2 musical lines doubled in octaves. One change Shostakovich makes is that the end of the quotation, where the 2 lines had ended in unisons and octaves, is altered to become a clashing minor second. This new ending leaves the passage unresolved and foreshadows the chordal clusters that would appear in the screen passages later in the quartet. The distinctive motive of the quotation in the upper line is the 2 ascending minor thirds or diminished triad and its half-step descent that is prominent in almost all of the 9 original passages. Recalling the original row of the quartet that played just before this quotation, the opening motive that appears twice also outlines a triad with a half-step descent. If the initial note of that motive were placed an octave lower, the contour would resemble the lament motive, and thus the opening row's prominent motive, the seminal motive of the quartet, could be considered as derivative of the previously written lament. Returning to the entire quotation, if we focus on the bottom line of the two lines, notice how the lower line is characterized by an oscillating minor third. Unto itself, the oscillating third seems simply to serve a contrapuntal function against the upper line, its only distinctive feature being its repetition. However, this distinction links the motive to a movement from the 14th symphony. Once again in The Suicide, this oscillating third is heard in the opening soprano line. The text said in this passage, three tall lilies on my grave without a cross, appears three times in Apollinaire's poem, and Shostakovich appropriately sets it with the same melody, making this oscillating third representative of the movement. Why then does the music from King Lear possibly refer to the suicide movement from the symphony, and why does Shostakovich use this quotation in the quartet? Despite its tragic subject, there is no suicide in Lear unless we consider the failed attempt by the Earl of Gloucester. We know that Shostakovich seriously contemplated suicide, but he was more likely concerned with the natural end to his life at this point. Perhaps the minor third motive itself has a distinctive meaning for the composer. In his writing on the 14th symphony, Levan Nakobien describes the character of the 12-tone rose used by Shostakovich in this way.
Movements 1, 3, 4, 7, and 10 of the 14th symphony emphasize rows based on seconds and thirds, rows with the topoi of living human emotions. Grief, sorrow, compassion.
The oscillating minor third from the suicide motive expresses grief, sorrow, and compassion appropriately, fit the intent of the lament from Lear, so perhaps this motive was, like the 12-tone technique, a topoi for the composer. But the question remains as to why he would choose to quote the music in the quartet. Shostakovich told his friend Isaac Glickman he was very attached to the music of the lament, and he was concerned the vocalese would go unrecognized because of the power of Kozintsev's cinematography. By quoting the lament in the quartet, Shostakovich is able to present a music without Kozintsev's images. But the significance of the quotation may go beyond that. It is essential to understand that the idea of the lament was conceived by Kozintsev for a scene in the movie that does not exist in Shakespeare's play. While it is common for movie versions of theatrical works to expand the primary source as a means for the director to express his own interpretation, this addition to the original is particularly telling. Kozintsev envisioned the lament as a work for chorus to represent the people so deeply affected by the war, but seemingly ignored by those who began it. A perspective not expressed in Shakespeare's plot.
The nine crowd scenes shown did not make the music sound like conventional choral singing. In its ancient meaning, the chorus was part of the action and took its rightful place in the tragedy. It was a tribal community raising its voice in lamentation for the dead. And so here in the film, in the very place where the powers of hatred and madness, the demonic element of tragedy, had broken free and raged, this voice grew strong. Grief brought people together, united them. The community grew, and now it was enveloping mankind.
Here we see the crowd scenes added by Kozintsev with the end of Shostakovich's lament. It is as if Kozintsev and Shostakovich want us to remember that the tragedy of Lear was not limited to the members of royalty, but also included the many unconsidered victims of their treachery. For Michael Mishra, the remembrance of those who died is also an important theme for Shostakovich's 14th Symphony.
Three times during the course of the fourth song, The Suicide, the victim bemoans the absence of a monument. Three lilies on my grave where no cross stands. This suggests yet another subject of the 14th Symphony, namely, remembrance. We can perhaps define this theme more specifically as the erecting of monuments, not just remembrance, but the very act of remembrance. As the suicide draws to a close, the bell chimes again as the narrator, for the last time, invokes the lilies and the grave with no cross. We are reminded that in the 13th Symphony, that same bell had been used to introduce the words, "There is no memorial at Babi Yar."
Thus, the allusion to the suicide in Lament could be heard not as referring to the tragedy of suicide, but to the tragedy of unmemorialized deaths. And what of the quotation of the Lament in the 13th string quartet? Given the function of the music in the film, what Kozintsev called a tribal community raising its voice in lamentation for the dead, then hearing the Lament excerpt in the quartet, Shostakovich's lament for deaths suffered within his own tribal community, unremembered deaths, is, in my opinion, not an inappropriate leap to make. Perhaps when we consider the 13th quartet, we may not just think of its subject as that of the composer's rumination on his own mortality, but also his remembrance of those who preceded him to the grave, those who had no memorial. Shostakovich himself identified the genesis of Symphony No. 14, reaching back to the orchestration of Mussorgsky's Songs and Dances of Death in 1962, 7 years before the symphony. But the 14th Symphony's polyphonic discussion of mortality and remembrance continues beyond the symphony into his King Lear score, both of which are melded into the language of the 13th quartet through direct quotation and allusion. Certainly, Shostakovich's preoccupation with death and mortality would continue in subsequent works until his own passing, but rarely is the polyphony as evident as it is between these three works. Thank you.
Thank you very much, William. Wonderful, very nuanced presentation, which I don't know, provokes a lot of thoughts for me, but I'll open it up first of all to questions from the gathering, if there are any. Okay, so let me then just ask you a couple things.
Sure.
First of all, is it your general sense, and this is a pretty simple question, that 12-tone composition as a topic in Shostakovich is invariably associated with, the sort of darker concepts? That's the first question. And the second thing is, my sense of that soundtrack to King Lear is that the music really seems to be in a different plane altogether than the visuals. It seems to be, I won't say mismatched there's just something about it that just seems so like broad and deep. And then you see this torch, this sort of village burning scene. And then you have this sound that seems like, something out of Ligeti in 2001. It's just so like cataclysmically deep. And it's unusual for him to actually write, that kind of choral music. So I guess the first question is, the issue about his use of 12-tone music in general. I mean, you notice the fact that there's a lot of tonal implications in that music, and the starkness of the sound stands out more against the tonal background. But right. Is it your sense that it is fundamentally a topic associated with death or not?
I don't know if it's necessarily associated with death as maybe chaos or, it seems to come prominence in the 14th Symphony, which of course is related to death in so many different ways. But it appears in the 12th quartet, 14th, even in the 15th quartet, all of which come at the end of his life when he seemed to have accepted it. So how they are necessarily related is obviously speculation. But I do think that he saw what, at least in my opinion, as a 12-tone technique as being a great way to represent chaos or darkness in in a time, but not in isolation, like in the second Viennese school kind of question, you know, where it was just one element of a larger scheme, and the fact that it wasn't just one row the whole time. It was a technique, and an effective one when it came to it. Peter Schmelz's articles, and then Levon Acobian on the 14th Symphony. Peter Schmelz does the article on the 12-tone usage across his rep, and then Acobian does all more on the 14th Symphony, which is rife with them. And it's a very interesting concept to be explored even more, how the way he composed the rows represented different feelings. So I don't know if it's necessarily death related, but it is certainly his, as Schmelz says, a topoi, the composer, in relating certain emotions, I want to say, or elements. So I don't know if that answers the question.
Well, yeah, it does in a sense. Like, what you're dealing with here is three musical objects, if you want to call them that, that seemingly are unrelated, right? And yet they have these points in common. And which actually suggests on one hand that perhaps, you know, one of the things that bothers me a little bit with Hakabyan is like the certainty of saying this gesture is this, and this is this, and this is this, and this is this, based on the text or based on what he thinks. Yeah. Right? Shostakovich doesn't tell us these things. So he's basically like turning these sounds into, yeah, into something that actually signify in a very specific way, as opposed to a kind of more broader generalized condition that actually belongs to music to express and is actually by definition something beyond words. And that's actually his exercise of labeling is confounded by this, I think, right? So I wonder whether or not, in fact, you can actually say that, you know, not dropping the other shoe perhaps, but just saying, there is all sorts of ways we can explore the connections between these works as morbid or something about where he's at in terms of his basket of intonations that he's working with it at the end. But there's also something about the fact that the disparate nature of these works and the fact that we have this sound field connecting them is actually telling us that there is no, you know, concrete specific quality of these sounds, but there is a sort of generalized affect that actually belongs to music on its own terms.
Yeah, I personally have always felt that, you know, the limitation of a musical work to only 12 tone is such a limiting issue. And I love Shostakovich's approach to the idea where it's one part of a larger concept, a technique to represent chaos or to represent confusion, or in this case, sorrow, with extreme chromaticism guaranteed by the 12 tone, but not outside of the tonal context.
Yeah. Okay, great. And there's also a question here from John Vanderbilt. I'll read it out to you. Was this level of intertextual quotation you mentioned using the lamenting motive in the quartet in order to highlight the music's power within the cinematic pictures, was that something that was picked up by other people? I'm curious about the reception of this relationship. Would it have been evident to others?
Well, the strange thing, of course, is that at least as far as in the recognition of the quotation was much later. So it's not necessarily clear that people even realized how many, when they were listening to the quartet, that it was there. The other really interesting thing is in the new collected works, there's some question in the author, in the research done, whether the lament was written for the quartet first or for the film first. It seems to me, because the opening of the nine fragments is shared by both, but the music after that is different. Clearly derived from the same thing. So the quotation that connects the two is the beginning and then it falls off. I think it was more what we see is Shostakovich being really attached to the music he wrote for the film, and so very often being disappointed that it was playing second fiddle to the images in the cinematography. He famously quoted saying that, "I don't mind Shakespeare's words covering my music, but I really hate it when horse hooves cover the music. That just doesn't make any sense." And I'm sure that many film composers feel that way, that you know, they want their music to stand on their own in a certain way. And when you have the film going on, you don't get the full attention paid to the music. I don't know it, it I just know that from Glickman's research and his letters that Shostakovich loved the music of the lament. And to me, that's the reason why I think it's not only in the film, but it's in the quartet too, so he could kind of express it without the images as well as with the images. How the intertextual relation was done, how the intertextual relationship was perceived is kind of hard to say, except for, you know, from Glickman and Shostakovich, who knew about it.
It's interesting that you pointed out, you have this, you say, well, of course, Shostakovich disdained film composition.
But yeah, it's
for someone who disdained it, he certainly did a lot of it.
He did it and did it very well. When he worked with a great director, he did. Of course, it was the propaganda films that he hated and so forth. And one of the questions I wanted to answer also for you, Simon, was the nature of the music's relation to the film. In Hamlet, Shostakovich was on set and he was watching the whole thing. In Lear, he was not. He was in poor health and he had to do a lot of the work separately. It's a much more Spartan score in Lear than it is in Hamlet. And I wonder if his separation from the production company might have had something to do with that. You know, that's one of the reasons why in the diary we see so many more, the diary of Kozintsev's diary, we see all these letters that Kozintsev was writing to Shostakovich. Instead of telling him on set directly, he had to write to him and say, I want this music, I want that music.
Yeah, I'm sure that is the case. Also, he might have gotten into a place where, if you're dealing with these, you know, heavier concepts that are beyond the physical, that you could actually just have a generalized sound world that could be just attached to. You know, it's like the difference between early Wagner and later Wagner, Parsifal. Yeah. The leitmotif complex is pretty free of the narrative. So, all right, wonderful. Anything else? 2 minutes before.
Keenan had a question, I think.
Okay, go ahead, please. Sorry, I didn't see the question.
Thanks. Just following up on John's question, I wonder if you could suggest to us if Shostakovich does not appear to have made these connections explicit to any audience members, what personal significance do you think they might have had to him? Certainly, whatever the nature of them is, he would have been best poised to understand them.
It's a really good question. One of the reasons why I associated much of the lament with the suicide from the 14th Symphony was, at least what I hear, is that it seems there's nothing in the lament that's related to suicide. It doesn't seem to be related that way, but the suicide text points to this fact that a suicide is very often not memorialized. You know, it's considered a shameful thing. And the issue of the suicide, one of the issues in the poetry is the death of the suicide has no memorial. And I wonder in some cases if the lament was this idea of a lament for all those who didn't have a memorial, those who had died before. That's a pure speculation on my part, but it makes me, the connection to the suicide makes me wonder if it was his own lament for those who went before. That's my guess as to what it was for and why the connection to the suicide third motive was there. And there is a quotation in a story in Elizabeth Wilson's work with quotation from the violist that took over the position from the Beethoven quartet who played this original piece. I'm forgetting his name right now, Drusen, I'm not pronouncing it correctly, where he spoke of meeting with Shostakovich around this time, and Shostakovich was constantly talking about those who had gone before him, those who had died and who were said to have died under mysterious circumstances. And he said, you know, there was no mystery to them whatsoever why they died. You know, and so I wonder if in his rumination of the 14th Symphony and his approach to death was thinking about what about people who had gone before him and had not been remembered.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Sure.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, William.